And when we're doing data stack development, where we're going to put the server, our data snap server somewhere, and now we can build clients that can run on Windows Phone 7, BlackBerry, Android, iPhone. We can build Macintosh clients that talk to data snap servers. We can build iPhone clients. You saw in the previous session the tweet server, where the data snap server, you have a writer that generates the source code for the client connectivity for all your server class methods that you expose. And so you want to make sure you think about where the application server is going to run and which clients are going to talk to it. They might be Delphi client, CBuilder client, might be a FireMonkey client running on Macintosh. And again, the application server for DataSnap doesn't care. The communication is through a TCP/IP port, an HTTP port. The packets going back and forth are JSON. We give you the code to parse the JSON, to marshal objects and parameters. So in DataSnap, while the servers are still native code servers in Delphi and C++, you can build clients on lots of different platforms. And we'll continue adding to the platforms in the future as well. So this example, I've got a server. And it's waiting for client connections. We've got a client, for example, that's a Windows client that's going to monitor connections. And then we've got a a FireMonkey client. Let's start one with, not with debugging. Oh, come back. Without debugging. And we have a Macintosh as well. So let's run this one. In this case, it's TCP/IP, it's JSON, and we don't have to worry about so we have our server somewhere here. Here's our server. Here's a client, a regular VCL client, a FireMonkey client for Windows, and a FireMonkey Macintosh client. In this case, there's no platform-specific need. It's simply using TCP/IP from the Macintosh to the DataSnap server, which has to run on Windows. We have DataSnap servers for Windows to start. So this is going to call every second to the DataSnap server. And we'll start up this client talking to the DataSnap server. Oh, you know what? I have to make sure I have the right IP address, so they're going to time out. Okay. Stop. All right. This one is 59133, so I have to come back and set the port correctly. Stop. Stop. I know it's a socket error. I know, because I put the wrong IP address. So that's why we echo the IP address in our server for demo purposes. I just didn't pay attention. Okay, so now it's connected and it's just starting to call. Let's go to our FireMonkey example and put, it timed out as well. Let's see, where did it go? Okay. Socket error, okay. So let's put the right IP address. And it's going to start calling. So now we have a couple different clients all talking to the DataSnap server. We can set the idle time of the clients to keep the connection alive so that if we stop the connection, it's still there. We can start up again. And, oh, where's the other one? Come back. Okay, shut up. Oh, here it is. It's still running over here, our Macintosh one. Oh, come back. There we go. So using DataSnap clients on VCL and FireMonkey, we can isolate some of the operating system dependencies by having our database one place, our business logic one place, build thin clients so that we don't have to think about database access from every client that we build. All right, let's stop these. We'll stop this one. And stop our connection server. Oh, we've still got one running, it looks like. Okay. Nope. And then I think the last thing to go through one more time is, not that one, is the build process for a FireMonkey application. So here's the iOS. So the way I do my development is I have, as I mentioned earlier, I have a Macintosh operating system. And I have VMware Fusion running. So when I'm developing, if I build my Macintosh application on my Windows machine, I have to eventually get it over to the Macintosh. Now, the platform assistant is there to move executables over to the Macintosh. It's fine. If I want to build an iOS application, I need to build, I'm building my source code on Windows, building my project. I'm creating an Xcode version of that same project, same source code. And then, but that's on my Windows machine. So I have to figure out, how do I get all that source code and those resources and those styles over to the Macintosh so that I can build it with Xcode? And the way I do that is I have VMware allows you to share folders. And so over on the Macintosh, I have a folder called Demos. And in the Demos folder, I have Macintosh and iOS projects. So here's my source code, my DPR and my DProj file. Here's my Win32 code. Since I can access that from Windows, it's a shared folder. And the Xcode gets sent by that DPR to Xcode. This Xcode folder is created with all of the Xcode specific, like the project file, the default icons, the build instructions. But all the rest of the source code is related from the Xcode project back to these original source files. So by sharing, or you could have a Macintosh and a Windows machine, or a Mac Mini and a Windows machine, and you could then share a folder on your Macintosh target. So by doing that, I can easily move back and forth from my Windows IDE when I open my project. That project is actually, if I hover over, is on the Z, is mapped to the Z drive, which is the demos folder on my Macintosh via VMware. And then under the covers, it's just source code, right? With styles and everything else, and a little bit of code to add items to a list box. In this case, I don't run from my Windows ID, I do the DPR to Xcode. Now, if you add, you only need to run DPR to Xcode if you add any resources to your project. If you put some new components in, if you add a style or change some styles, all of that information is kept in the form file and in the project file. So we need to run this periodically, this DPR to Xcode, to make sure that the Xcode projects gets updated. In the future, we'll make that automatic. For now, you just run it. If you're just changing code, source code, you don't have to run the DPR to Xcode project. It's only to, if you add a new unit, if you add something else that needs to be part of the Xcode build project. I just find that I just run it. It runs very fast, as you saw, so that way I don't have to worry. And then I go back over to my Macintosh, and I load Xcode project. And here's the PNGs, the source code, and such. And we'll choose the emulator. In this case, I've got iPhone and iPad 4.3. You can set breakpoints in Xcode, so you can actually debug your iPhone, Delphi, Free Pascal source code. We give you the Free Pascal compiler. We give you the Free Pascal runtime library. We give you the FireMonkey runtime library for iOS. It sits in a package file on the install directory on Windows. You copy that over to your Macintosh and install. It has its own installer. It'll look for Xcode where you've installed it, and it will then install the compiler and the libraries so Xcode knows about them. You have full source code highlighting and such. Let's see what happened here. Did I hit run? Maybe I didn't. You can use the Xcode debugger to step through your event handler code, all of those things. So let's see why. Oh, here it goes. Okay. So there's a splash screen. You can define that. Here's a glow effect around an edit box. We can add some strings. We notice we have reflection. You can set the height of the reflection. Sort of shows up two lines. You can set the depth list box. And again, here's those, which you saw before, the blur effect or not.